Shalom, to all in all. As you can recall, we ran out of tape on the study of Christ's humanity. But just to quickly conclude, Jesus Christos never really pled guilty, yet he was condemned. And there is a similar case that occurred in the United States in 1970. It was North Carolina versus Alford. And Alford was charged with first-degree murder, and he pleaded to second-degree murder and resulted in a 30-year prison sentence. And now he appealed, and he stated that he pled guilty under fear of the death sentence, but that was in fact the only reason for fear that he pled guilty, but he himself still believed innocent. And so, well, to make it quick, briefly, courts go over this, and they ended up establishing the what is now known as the Alford Plea, which enables a person being convicted to plead guilty because there is enough evidence to condemn him, yet he himself still believes to be innocent. So he is not really saying that accepting guilt, but admitting that under the circumstances and the amount of evidence presented against him is enough to indict him, to condemn him to any sentence. And so Americans think that this was the first time in history that this ever occurred, but 2,000 years ago, more or less, this is something that Jesus Christos went through similar. Now, because really, Jesus, all he said was, thou sayest that I am. So he himself never admitted guilt, but he knew that through ignorance, that was enough to condemn him. Now, as I was researching this, another interesting note that I came across was the Habaeas Corpus, which means in the Latin, it means, may I have the body? And just to finish off really quickly, think about it. You know, they say here in the United States, one is innocent until proven guilty, right? Well, then how come, for example, if you're incarcerated, you're told that you have 3 days, and if you're not called up for court within those 3 days, then you are released, and in fact, you are released if you don't attend court. But you see, the Habeas Corpus was established for rich personnel, for wealthy individuals in prison. You see, it basically demands that whoever is holding you against your will present the evidence and the authority that they have over you, that they in fact are authorized by whomever to hold you against your will. And I'm sure there's a lot more behind that, but basically, in a nutshell, it's if you're innocent until proven guilty, then there's no possible proof of authorization to hold you. And still, thousands, if not millions of people throughout the U.S. are held against their will 3 days unless receiving court. And in fact, that is supposed to be illegal. Because if you're innocent, then see, either they give you a court date or session that instant, or they have to let you go. Because you're not guilty until proven guilty in court. So another, you know, when I thought about it was pretty clear. It was, that's right. Because I admit, I've been incarcerated, and you're held 3 days. But if you're innocent, then they have no authority to hold you against your will. So just really briefly, I guess that's about it on the Christ humanity. Well, go ahead and do your own studies. There's a whole lot more, but I'll end there. And so, shalom, take care. Jah, guide and protect all and I. Thank you. Okay, shalom. I guess speaking of all this legal matter, go ahead and sue me for false advertisement. I said I was pretty much done, and here I am again. But now, I'd like to address two points that just came to me. One, Alford distribution. Is it Budweiser, Bud Light, and all of that? Are they admitting that all evidence leads to them being guilty of all the atrocities and death that their products produce? And but that's not really the important point. The next point is very interesting. You see, okay, if you go really quickly to Matthew, chapter 27, what is it, verse 57, it says, "When the even was come, there came a rich man of Arimathea, I can't really pronounce that well, sorry, named Joseph, who also himself was Jesus's disciple. He went to Pilate and begged the body of Jesus. Then Pilate commanded the body to be delivered." And then also in Mark chapter 15, verse, one second, please. Okay, it's going to be verse 43. It reads, "Joseph of Arimathea, an honorable counselor, which also waited for the kingdom of God, came and went in boldly to Pilate and craved the body of Jesus. And Pilate marveled if he were already dead, and calling to him the centurion, he asked him whether he had been any while dead. And when he knew of it, the centurion, he gave the body to Joseph." Okay, and then he wraps the body up in fine linen. And okay, so basically, I don't really know what the heck is going on, but what I do know, it's related to the Habaeas Corpus, because and the 3 days, because it's Jesus Christos is 3 days in the belly of the beast, or 3 days for his resurrection. And that's the days that you're allowed to be held against your will in prison or jail. And then you receive a trial, judgment, and then you come back to life or so. And it's interesting. Just, I mean, I'm gonna go into it, but just wanted to let all know that this is getting very interesting, because Joseph of Arimathea, he's reclaiming that body. I guess it would read Habaeus Corpus, may I have the body, and then the 3 days and the resurrection. And then Pilate tells him that if he's been dead a while. So it's very interesting. And the young man that's naked, that's wearing a white linen covering, or I forgot what you call that, but anyways, there's a lot to go into, so I hope this is of much help. It is to I'm kind of excited about this. So, shalom again. Thank you for your time.